Of all the fears that humans have endured throughout our history, none have been more consistently present and terrifyingly effective than our fear of the unknown. The terror of what we don't know is so powerful that it holds roots in the foundations of many other fears. Nyctophobia, our fear of the dark, stems from not knowing what could be lying in its blank depths, our imaginations running amok over what we can't see. Fear of certain animals, like arachnophobia, often sprouts from how alien and unfamiliar they look and not out of their actual ability to do harm. But somewhere, in the back of our minds, we wonder, unknowingly, what their unfamiliar forms are capable of. Our fear of certain places, like deep caves, scorching wastelands, and the unfathomable ocean, is born from how inhospitable and unexplored these areas of our own world are. The deep ocean in particular is a terrifying concept that's been explored in great depths, pun intended, in games. Like many people, I have thalassophobia, and personally, games like Subnautica, Narcosis, and Soma are some of the scariest I've ever seen because of this. But nothing that embodies this fear of the unknown is as prevalent and impactful as space. Its screamless infinity and the anxiety-inducing speculation that it breeds dominates our media with our own horrified fascination over what could be in films like Alien, 2001 A Space Odyssey, and my personal favourite, Moon. It culminates all these other inherent fears of humanity. The darkness, the fear of alien unfamiliarity, the unsurvivable hostility of certain environments. Games have explored this area probably more than any other media, in classics like Dead Space, Alien Isolation, Halo. Among them all, my favourite is by far 2017's Prey. The reason I love Prey isn't because of how much it revolutionised our view of this genre, but because of how well it brought all these elements of emotional delivery together, and how much it nailed that sense of space and the multiple sources of fear that it induces. The biggest criticism I've heard surrounding the game is that it's basically modern System Shock or Bioshock in space. And while this could be construed as a compliment, with both these being iconic, well-made games, it's often said to dismiss any unique elements or personality that this game has, and I couldn't disagree more. While I don't think the atmosphere is as good as Bioshock, I think it adds so many more elements to make it its own unique and commendable experience. Prey captures it all. The anxious parallel of isolation within the vast openness. The threat of some bigger and stronger being than us swimming through the darkness. The worry that it's our own hubris and ignorance that can bring it all crashing down. Prey doesn't necessarily have negative reviews, much like Sunset Overdrive, another great game I made a video essay on, but it absolutely deserved better than it got at release. And today, I want to talk about Prey and why I think it's so underrated. As usual, I want to thank you for watching this video. And it also includes chapters for your viewing convenience, as it's probably going to be pretty long. Oh, and by the way, Happy Halloween! Story's a lot more involved here than with Sunset Overdrive, so I'll first walk you through the narrative of the game before I give my thoughts on it. What you're about to see is one interpretation of how to play this game, my story, but your journey will be whatever you make it. And obviously this video is probably going to contain a lot of spoilers, but I think there's a lot more reason to play this game than just where the story ends up, so this'll still be potentially a call to play the game yourself, if you haven't already. Before we start, I want to give props to any game that has adaptive difficulty sliders. It makes so much more variety for gameplay than just an easy, medium-hard selection. In this game, you can choose to have O2 consumption for zero gravity areas, so you only have a limited amount of time in vacuum of space. Adaptive injuries are the best thing to add if you're looking for a challenge. It adds new mechanics that are affected by how, and how well, you play. Fall from a great height and you'll break your leg, unable to sprint until you properly heal it again. We haven't even jumped into the game yet, and there's already great reasons for replayability, one of this game's strongest points, and it only gets better once you enter this world. So, let's begin. You wake up. You're in your apartment. Your name is Morgan Yu. You're a scientific engineer, and you've got a big day ahead of you. It's your first day starting experimental trials at the Transtar Corporation. Your brother, Alex, is a big player at the company and greets you with a message on your communicator, known as a transcribe. After donning your company suit, you set off to the elevator and take a helicopter ride a short, privileged tier distance to Transtar HQ. Like, seriously, just get a car there. But I guess then we couldn't see the famous San Francisco Arcane Bridge. Although I will admit, this is a very cool way to do opening credits. Inside, we begin our testing upon meeting Dr. Bellamy. They're rudimentary tests followed by a psychological morality evaluation. This evaluation poses the typical morality scenarios you've heard about. People on train tracks, switches, and pushing one fat man to save more people. These moral scenarios are a little overplayed and contrived at this point, but it sets a great precedent for the themes of the game, humanity and morality, and your answers link very well to overall decisions and plot situations. Mid-test is when things take a very strange turn.
I want you to take a good look at it. In a moment, I'm going to ask you what... Is my coffee? It's empty.
Oh my god! Security! Security!
I love this introduction and how it's framed. On repeat playthroughs, it seems so obvious where to put your eyeline, but initially you're being told to take a Rorschach test and it pulls your focus. So obviously, when some creature pops up on the edge of the screen, you're like, what the fuck? As a security measure, your test room is filled with gas and you're knocked unconscious, your perspective fading to black in the face of this horrific nightmare. You wake up. You're in your apartment. Your name is Morgan Yu. You're a scientific engineer, and you've got a big day ahead of you. It's your first day starting experimental trials at the Transtar Corporation. Your brother, Alex, is a big player at the company and greets you with a message on your communicator, known as a transcribe. After donning your company suit, you set off to the elevator. But something seems off. Something isn't right. The nightmare continues. It's here a mysterious voice tells you you need to escape your apartment. Finding a wrench, your only way out is a glass window leading to your balcony. This is another awesome moment to experience the first time, a real mind freak. You weren't in your apartment, but in a simulated room being held within some kind of lab. This whole experience, the apartment, the helicopter ride, the Transtar offices, it was all an artificially guided sequence. And when we find ourselves on the other side of the testing rooms, we also find what caused our earlier tests to come to an abrupt end, and why this lab seems so abandoned.
Typhon Cacoplasmus. Everyone calls them mimics. Be careful what you pick up.
The thing that attacked Dr. Bellamy is trapped, but not contained. As we move further into the lab, we find more examples of these mimics run amok. If you've played other RPGs, you're familiar with mimics, monsters that pop up every now and again, usually disguised as a chest, imbuing each encounter with a potential treasure, something usually helpful and welcome, with a continuous sense of doubt, with that fear of the unknown, and it never leaves you. Once you know a game has mimics, you're approaching each instance of what could be a mimic encounter with wariness.
No! No! I saw the teeth!
Prey takes that concept, that anxiety and doubt, and inflates it as its core concept. It's not just a chest anymore, it's everything. Nothing is safe. Everything could be a mimic. And what's more, they're mobile, and they're fast. We're introduced to one of the first core gameplay concepts, multiple ways to approach an objective. Regardless, in this first instance, going through the door or the vent will take you to the same place and introduce a new threat.
That was a phantom. Typhon Anthrophantasmus. Keep moving.
Shortly after, we find our first real weapon, more of a tool, and it's one of Prey's most unique elements, the glue gun. It can fire clumps of climbable, instant-hardening glue to create makeshift staircases up to usually out-of-reach places, and more importantly, at this stage in the game, it can solidify enemies in their place, giving you valuable breathing room in combat. A following encounter with several mimics shows just how effective this can be at dealing with situations where you feel outnumbered. We're in a lobby, a real lobby this time, and we're directed towards a Dishonored reference. There's some kind of device ahead of us known as a Neuromod, and if you're squeamish, you're gonna really love this part. Ooh, eye stuff. I hate it. Neuromods are the single most important piece of tech you'll find. They're your source of leveling up. You can use these to acquire new abilities like hacking, repairing, inventory size, damage increases, health boosts. It's all done with Neuromods. After installing our first Neuromod, we're once again contacted over our transcribe by the mysterious voice, an entity known as January, who plays a similar role as Atlas in Bioshock, who then urges us to leave. And once we do, we come to a major realization.
You made it. Ready for your first real view of the world?
Morgan was never on Earth. Everything we've seen so far has been part of a larger facility in the middle of space, Talos 1. This thing is humongous and unbearably rich, and clearly a lot of rich elites have invested in it. But it's cold and without empathy, it's overflowing with a disgusting, unlikable bile, and it's breaking apart at the seams. But despite all these similarities to Amy Schumer, what separates this station is that it has a purpose. And as we step into a museum room in the main lobby, the relics and plaques thankfully give some background information about how such a grand facility could come to be. We exist in an alternate universe. In this timeline, President John F. Kennedy was never assassinated, and it had far-reaching effects into the future. There's a reason this space station is here, and a reason we're on it. And to explain that, we have to go all the way back to 1958. Cold War tensions were high between the United States and the Soviet Union, and both nations' goal to dominate the stars had kicked off the space race. Within the universe of Prey, the Soviet government launched a satellite, Verona 1, which fell radio silent 2 years later. A crew was sent to investigate, but they never made it back to Earth. The Russian government discovered that the satellite was interrupted by a hostile alien threat. Once they realized that there was no way they could handle this threat alone, they approached the United States government in secret with a proposition to collaborate resources in order to combat this non-terrestrial entity that killed their cosmonauts. By this point, Kennedy had been elected. He was already incredibly interested in promoting America's space travel research, pouring billions of dollars into trying to beat the Soviets in a race to put a man on the moon. But the only threat larger than invasion from another nation was invasion from another world entirely. And much like the Soviets' leader Khrushchev, he realized they had a common enemy to prepare for. They collaborated to establish the Kletka program, an initiative that built a containment cell around the Verona satellite in order to study whatever unknown creature destroyed it. Over the years, they expanded on the facility, but you can still find the initial satellite at the heart of the station, and we'll pass it later as we explore our way through. But this cooperation didn't repair the two nations' relations. Tensions were still high. Whether through Soviet intervention or not, the attempt on Kennedy's life was still made. This time, it failed. The truce between the two nations ended, but as intent on expanding into space as ever, Kennedy wrestled control of the Kletka station away from the Soviets and launched an America-only research initiative, Project Axiom. It's the basis for what would become the initiative of the station we're currently on, and you can find references to this throughout the game. Research continued up until 1980, where the entities once again broke containment, killing everyone on board the research station. In response, the government abandoned the Axiom project and left the station's remains in the hands of the highest bidder. Over 40 years later, the Transtar Company was established. Much like how Aperture started as a shower curtain company and would go on to build a revolutionary gigantic science facility, Transtar began as a food distribution supplier and eventually became viable enough to buy the Kletka facility, using it to research the alien life forms inside for the advancement of scientific application and production, as well as new methods for combating it as a threat. Effectively, they're trying to make humans stronger and smarter, for numerous and not always moral reasons, using research gained from the alien entities. It's never explained how Transtar became aware of the organisms or how they managed to recontain them, as the incident on the station was most likely kept hidden from the public. Regardless, Transtar eventually revamped the station to suit their own scientific needs. It's now 2035 and we're on board Transtar's reinvigorated space facility, Talos 1. It's cool to note that in Greek mythology, Talos is a giant automaton made of pure bronze, much like the aesthetic of the station, and Talos' job was to protect the princess Europa, who resided on Crete, from being invaded by pirates, much like how the job of the station is to act as a giant automated facility to protect Earth from being invaded by this unknown threat called the Typhon. We'll learn more about the danger on board as we travel through the station, but it's very clear that, once again, it's escaped containment, and we're now trapped in space with these things. We'll also learn more about the achievements and inhabitants of the station as we explore it more. A few daunting encounters later and we finally make it to our only real safe spot in the game.
Oh my god!
Our home away from home, Morgan's office. There's only one person there that can explain who we are, what we're doing, and what needs to be done next. And that's Morgan herself.
Hello, Morgan. Tough day, right? If I'm talking to myself, it must be. Your memory's shot full of holes, I know. I'm sorry, but it's permanent. So the first thing you need to know is you can trust January. It's an operator, a sort of backup of you and me. It knows what you've forgotten. We've been testing a new kind of neuromod based on the Typhon organisms, mapping their neural patterns onto ours. Problem is, when you uninstall a neuromod, it resets your memory back to the moment you first put it in. That's why you forget. There's supposed to be a process that brings you back up to speed between test runs, but someone could just skip that part, turn a single day into your entire life. Well, that's exactly what Alex did. The question is, why? You're not going to like what I have to say next.
Damn videos. Sorry, but I can't let you listen to that. Not until I've had a chance to explain everything in person. For now, just... Damn it. I have to go. Just sit tight. Please.
Before we get a chance to hear the full speech, our brother Alex cuts the video servers. It's clear he's still alive on the station somewhere, trying to fix everything that's happened, but with his own motives. We're unsure of whose side he's on, whose side we're on. For now, we've got to make our way down to Hardware Labs and repair the servers for these videos in the workshop of Dr. Calvino, who developed this screen technology, so we can watch the rest of that video. Just an aside, the design of this three-dimensional looking glass technology is fantastic. Like, as an element of video game design, there are instances where I genuinely don't know how they managed to pull it off. It's really creatively done, and in terms of some of the puzzle solving and world building, it actually comes in very useful to have it designed like this. And as an interesting tidbit, Looking Glass was the name of one of the companies that developed System Shock 2, the spiritual predecessor to Prey, along with Irrational Games, who would go on to develop Bioshock under the name 2K Boston. Anyway, on to Hardware Labs to repair that looking glass server. Hardware Labs is our first proper area, where you feel you have the freedom to explore and utilise what you've learned so far, while teaching you some new ways to play. The way this game directs you in these tutorial areas is wonderful. It's incredibly nuanced, and if you're playing repeat playthroughs and you retain this information, or figure out a new way to look at area exploration or puzzles, you're rewarded for it. For example, when you first enter Hardware Labs, there are balconies above you that you usually have to work your way through the entire area to access. Keeping this in mind on your second playthrough and having become more acquainted with the utility of the glue cannon, you can get a head start up to this balcony early on, which gets you an advantageous drop on a couple of enemies and early access to some better equipment. However, speaking of repeat playability, if you decide to play an entirely different way on a new playthrough than you previously have, you'll still find a challenge here because you'll be unfamiliar with how to approach a certain situation using your new preference or build. You're rewarded for retaining information or thinking three-dimensionally, and you're challenged appropriately for starting from scratch or taking risks. As far as an explorative simulation game goes, that is fantastic design. Calvino's workshop needs his keycard to access. You can find most people's relevant keycards on their bodies, and this is where the game teaches you how to locate specific crew members of Talos 1 throughout the security booth's computer systems. You can find everyone, living or dead, that's still on board the station through these terminals by activating their tracking bracelets. When we do manage to locate Calvino though, we have a bigger problem on our hands. Remember when we first entered the lobby of Talos 1 and we saw a hole get blown into the side of the station? Yeah, he was in that hole. Only way to get to him now is to go out there. Airlocks are an important part of Talos 1 and the gameplay in general. There's three major ways to get around the station, the airlocks being the first one we're introduced to. Want to get from one end of the ship to the other? Well, you can just spacewalk across the exterior. I really want to talk about the spacewalking, but let me fawn a little more over the Hardware Labs first. The airlock resides in the satellite room.
Are you sure about that?
This room is honestly one of my favorites in the game. There's almost every element of gameplay versatility at play here. Dealing with Typhon enemies, robotic enemies, using power and computer terminals, turrets, vertical traversal for hidden items, accessing areas through multiple means, radioactive leaks, security hacking, secret entrances to side rooms, puzzle solving, using tools like the glue cannon, our first legitimate crafting tutorial, and various throwables to access new areas or deal with encounters. It's all here, and it's one of the rooms that I've played differently on every one of my 7 playthroughs. This is really commendable. By this point, I've decided what kind of gameplay route I'm going for. Up from weapon fire, stealth, secondary abilities, relying heavily on crafting, relying heavily on pickups, relying on medkits or food for healing, all that kind of stuff. And this room is designed to lean into presenting you with a challenge no matter what route you've taken. I actually found myself getting swarmed on the playthrough I recorded because I was playing in a way I'd never done before and so was confronting the room from a whole new perspective for the first time. If that's not good design, I don't know what is. That being said, I'm usually really good in this room, like, you guys don't know. Like, my other playthroughs, I'm so good on. I swear. Hardware Labs is also where you'll discover a lot of the game's tools and weapons for the first time. The standard weapons are basically your pistol and your shotgun, but Prey really encourages you to think outside the box with enemy encounters, so gives you an array of unique tools to use as well. Aside from the glue gun, there's the stun gun, which while only lethal for robotic enemies, can give you valuable breathing room against a particularly formidable foe. And the Q-beam, a laser tool that corrodes away at an enemy's health bar. Whatever's left is all the health you have to deal with, if you don't just finish them off with the beam first. There's also a number of intriguing throwables the game has. An EMP charge does what it says on the tin. A Typhon lure will attract and gather Typhon enemies towards it. The null wave transmitter will negate Typhon's psychoshock based powers. And my personal favourite, the recycler charge, will act as a portable black hole, sucking in and destroying anything nearby and turning it into craftable materials, including enemies. You can also plant these on doorways and nearby surfaces, so they make excellent traps for securing whatever room you're in. It's not necessarily an effective weapon, but a nerf crossbow, the Huntress Boltcaster, can be good for stealth runs, pulling enemies to certain spots through distractions and opening doors through secondary projectile means. You can find the schematics to this Boltcaster through emails hinting at a station-wide nerf war that was happening on the base, which is a fun little detail. You'll also get introduced to machine-based enemies in this area. Operators are basically floating Roombas aboard Talos 1, and I'm in no way simplifying the concept of operators, folks. They act as informational and task-based assistants, engineering and medical droids, that kind of thing. You'll encounter corrupted versions that will attack you as well. With enough hacking skill, they can be turned in your favor and fortified, along with portable turrets. Non-corrupted operators can be a good source for a free heal or a suit repair, so on higher difficulties, it's essential to utilize their presence. We're now ready to get through that first airlock. Each of these can only be used once you've unlocked them from the inside, meaning you'll have to visit a location with an airlock the hard way before you can use the exterior of the ship to fast travel there. Before we step out, the game properly teaches us about crafting. You can do it before now, but for first timers, it gives you incentive. Once we have a propulsion jetpack that we can use to get around in zero gravity, we can step outside into open space.
Microgravity detected.
There it is. The great darkness. The vast unknown of the cosmos. There's plenty of games where you can fly around in space, and plenty of games where you can go from planet to planet. And in essence, it's not like you can just float out into the nothingness here, forever and ever. But man, it sure feels like it. No rope tether, no crew to rescue you. You're just out here, floating alone, in front of infinity. I've never played a game that captures this feeling better. Films have done it really well before. I recommend the Helping Hand short from Love, Death and Robots as a reference. But this, you're playing this. You can feel this. Look, there's the moon, and there's Earth, full of bastards. The exterior of the ship is massive and, for now at least, relatively free of external threats. We can still track Calvino's bracelet to where his body lies. Remember that if you choose the option on startup, O2 limitation is a cause for concern out here. You can find canisters around the blown out office to remind you. Am I a pussy if I tell you that I've never played the game on limited O2? I can't deal with that kind of anxiety, man. Also, there's a safe here. It is nigh on impossible to have enough neuromods at this point of the game to achieve the high enough hacking level needed to get into this. You are absolutely meant to come back and search the exterior of the ship and every other area once you're leveled up enough. I love games like that. Reminds me of coming back to the Village of All Beginnings and Toonby to meet the witch when you're black and white with super pants and a psychic fish and all that shit. You probably have no idea what I just said there. Anyway, Calvino's keycard is on his body. We take it and head back inside to get into that office and repair the looking glass network. It's also here some of that looking glass puzzle solving comes into play. You have three screens, all viewing the office from a different angle. Play back the right video and watch it at the right angle, and listen to some of the audio logs talking about weight locks and a handcrafted thermos, and all this information comes together to reveal a secret stash of neuromods. The way this game gives you information, man, I fucking love it. With the servers restored, we'll head back to our office in the lobby and watch the rest of that video for some new revelations that almost make us wish we hadn't.
You're not going to like what I have to say next. You have to destroy Talos 1. The research, the Typhon, nothing can survive. Including you. I know how it sounds, but you've seen what those creatures can do. They're a part of you now. If even one cell gets back to Earth, we're lost. I'm sorry. I wish there was another way. January can walk you through activating the self-destruct mechanism. Alex will try to stop you. He's allergic to failure. Too proud to go back to Mom and Dad with his tail between his legs. So, it's up to you now. Good luck. Told you you wouldn't like it.
Morgan, us, wants us to destroy the entire station, and with it, the Typhon threat on board. The benefit is that it'll stop the Typhon from reaching Earth, with the only kicker at the minute being that we'll probably have to die in the process too. Our mysterious guide, January, shows themselves. It's an operator, programmed by us and built with our personality and goals. It's clear that there's a conflict of intentions here between Alex and January, which is to say the old version of you, before the mind wipe. Fuck, now I've got to explain the mind wipe. Okay, I'll put this briefly because the lore of this game is stacked. Basically, neuromods are still in the experimental phase as they're crafted with Typhon organic material, and it turns out you are the lead guinea pig. They allow humans to learn anything instantly, like learn instruments or lifting heavy weights, but when you uninstall a neuromod, it resets your memory back to the point when you first installed it. So obviously, being a neuromod guinea pig and having so many installed and uninstalled, you're pretty ganked up. That's why you still thought you were in your apartment at the beginning of the game, complete memory reset. Now, how exactly our earlier self ended up in a mental headspace where we deemed it necessary to destroy the station and everything we'd been working on will be explained later. Our next destination is a section called Deep Storage, with the intention of reacquiring Morgan's trigger key to arm the reactor so we can detonate the station. It's one of two we'll need to self-destruct Talos 1, with the other being our brother, Alex's. We can use the main lift, the second most reliable way to get around, although it only has three stops in the major departments. Unfortunately, as is always the case, it was never going to be as simple as stepping into the lift, and some kind of interference is stopping it from activating. It's coming from a location called the Arboretum, accessible through the hell that is the Psychotronics department. Psychotronics. If you've had fun getting bang bang shooty with your shotty up to this point and the insinuation that this is supposed to be a horror game has worn off, Psychotronics is here to remind you to keep your diaper well and truly on. Over half a dozen times through, it still unsettles me. It's got the first real batch of difficult enemies that you can't just clash horns with head on. This area kicks it up so high, I got messed up just trying to get down the fucking stairs at the entrance. God damn. This is the initial facility that the Verona satellite was built around. This is where it all went down. Buckle your ass.
Psychotronics is the opposite of safe, Morgan. What are you after?
I can eavesdrop on your brother's messages. We're in agreement on this one. Get through this place fast as possible.
As at odds as Alex and January are, the fact they both agree that Psychotronics is nowhere you want to be just sets the atmosphere of tension so well in this area. The music is also anxiety-inducing. This particular track plays in other areas, but its uneasy tones are just so perfect as you step into this foreboding space. The music in general is really good. While it doesn't have particularly memorable melodies, it's a massive atmosphere sponge. Most areas of the game would have their effectiveness dampened without the tracks that are there. They're clearly composed very accurately to be effective for this game's world. Just listen to the key changes here and how it builds up tension by making the notes rise higher. It makes you feel so uneasy. Every passing shadow, every flickering light, every diegetic noise makes you shoot up like a helpless gazelle about to be ambushed. Why did this alarm just go off? Did I just hear a can roll? Ah! The spooks! We also find one of the most important pieces of gear in our arsenal, the Psychoscope, a headset that allows you to scan enemies and learn each type of enemy's specific weaknesses, and unlock new sets of their abilities in the process. You can also fit it with upgrades, the first one being that you can now detect mimics while they're disguised as other objects. I don't really like this one, it just means that whenever I hear a noise or see an item roll, I'm never gonna find out organically through investigation whether it's a mimic trying to trick me, or if I just waste a bullet by pumping an anxiety-riddled shot into a fallen trash can. I think it robs you of that paranoia that keeps you on your toes entering every single room when you can just turn a scanner on and see, oh, it is a mimic. Still, that aside, the Psychoscope is a great piece of kit. We get a tutorial for it further on when we can get some free scans on captured Typhon to demonstrate how we can learn their weaknesses and upgrade our own strengths. Tutorials aren't too bad in this game. Like I said, it often teaches you things incredibly fluidly during gameplay, and I've expressed in the past my disdain for tutorials that halt gameplay entirely to teach you something. So this is probably my least favourite, as you absolutely have to go about and do these scans before you can even proceed to the next room. Like, if you're on your 8th playthrough, you know how to scan. I don't need to be gated off here. In an offshoot room, we get further world building as we find video footage of the first contact with the Typhon back in 1960. It took at least 3 playthroughs for me to finally piece all this backstory and information on the world together because, again, all the information on the game is built organically into your exploration of the world. You can miss a lot of this information by just not being thorough or not paying attention to the details, and the same goes for all kinds of information, character relationships and work projects shared through emails, or where the bodies of certain crew members should be, based off information you can find elsewhere. It all links. There is so much attention put into making all this info run smoothly together, and then most of it's just hidden away somewhere. You have to care and be inquisitive in order to go find it. You know how in most RPGs you can always get codexes and compendiums and find a ton of books and shit, but only a few of them are usually only ever necessary. Most of the writing adds cool info to the world, but you can basically just skip through them for the reading XP or the completionist requirement without actually reading the entries themselves. And it doesn't matter whether you pay attention to all that reading or not, it's all just fluff. Here, paying attention to all that data that can be found and how it all links from place to place and person to person, 8 times out of 10, it will matter. It won't be necessary to advance, but it will build a greater idea of the in-world characters and events, and you'll almost certainly benefit from it in some way. Each email, audio file, and piece of historical data will be a puzzle piece in a 1,000-piece jigsaw. The more of them you have, the greater your view of the bigger picture will be. There's a great horror-inspired moment in an offshoot room here, where you're tricked into getting jump-scared by a fake enemy, then get cornered by a real enemy who can't see you behind a looking glass. So many moments like this only happen one way, but they are so enjoyable because of how uniquely built and directed they are. They're carefully constructed encounters, like a film shot. Even though it's predictable, I'd say it actually has greater longevity in its effectiveness because you're always getting a high-quality moment when you encounter it. I'd compare it to a lot of memorable moments in the early Resident Evil games. You know when dogs are going to jump out for the first time, or the hallway where the first liquor encounter is going to take place. But it's fun every time, because that moment is fixed, and it's framed, and it's special. As we keep finding neuromods and getting stronger, we get a warning from January about how far neuromods can truly go. They're the whole reason this station is here, to take the fluid mimicry ability of the Typhon and find a way to use it to make humans stronger. But if we keep scanning the Typhon, we'll gain their abilities, and, in the process, there's the risk of adding more of them to us, potentially blurring the line between Typhon and human. We've already had the Typhon power skill trees open to us. Whether we'll actually use them, whether we'll want to use them to survive, will be down to player choice. The option is there. The risk is yours. In the room beyond, we find Ground Zero, the Verona satellite. It's surrounded by a golden substance in the air, some ribbon of filament created by a new Typhon threat, a Weaver. We can see one of these things is created by the combination of mimics, and in terms of the spread of the Typhon, they're probably the biggest threat. They act as the sinew of the organism, the roots of the tumor that grows and spreads, with these golden lights following in their wake. I'm rushing through a lot of detail in these areas as I focus on the story, but every one is worth exploring, and there's lots of side rooms here that, as I said, will teach you more about the Typhon and the inhabitants of Talos 1. Test rooms for how enemies behave and the utilities that the crew were constructing to combat them. One room in particular reminds you about the game's themes on morality. There's a lot of games where morality options are a thing, even great games like Dragon Age Inquisition, but they're often not really integrated into the world or the story of the game. It doesn't have a fundamental reason to be there. In Prey, there are constant encounters to keep you thinking about who you are, or at least, who you want to be in this playthrough, and the effects of morality on our own human nature. In this instance, a volunteer is trapped in a testing chamber, You have the option of letting him go or completing the test by releasing a mimic that will kill him. On further investigation, you find this is a convict guilty of some pretty heinous stuff, but he promises to give you a code for a side room with some valuable tools if you help him. But this guy is record. Can he really be trusted? Is he gonna attack you as soon as you let him out? First time playing this, there's so much to doubt and you're never given a clear resolution to the conflicting information. He says some of it's lies and he's done some bad stuff, but he's never hurt anyone. It's your final choice to lean off your own interpretation, one way or the other. Clearly, the implication is that showing mercy is the good option and letting him die is kind of bad, even if you have a reason to kill him. I mean, there is a third option. You could just keep your hands clean, do nothing, and leave him in there to rot. But I have a policy, like a personal policy, where child endangerment is kind of like the worst crime that there is. So does that make me a bad person if my initial instinct is just, yeah, throw the switch on the guy, I don't give a shit. But again, that's if these criminal records turn out to be truthful. Later on, we find out that Transtar isn't above falsifying criminal records in order to get hold of some of these volunteers. So there is evidence to suggest the chance that this could all be bullshit. Morality in real life is rarely clear-cut or seen through a fogless lens. Contrary to how everybody on Twitter seems to talk to other people, we're never mutually good folk or bad folk. And that hesitation in how we perceive each other is probably what defines humans more than any other creature, as well as our biggest fallibility. Do you want to trust your instincts and jump to a conclusion? Or do you want to stay neutral and hesitate to get more information, if there is any? The risk, the choice, is yours. Eventually, we survive the onslaught of new enemies and new information within Psychotronics and make our way to the other side, to the guts. When the lifts don't work and the airlocks are, well, locked, when all else fails, you can always use guts. It's the third and final surefire way through the station, mainly being a tunnel network to transport supplies and cargo from one area to another, but in a pickle, it can transport you. It's a zero gravity area that's fairly linear, and there's not much to talk about here with the exception of some world building side rooms, but it gives you a chance to encounter a Weaver when it's not behind glass, and see what they're like in action. A total pain in the asshole. Their screech can disorient and stun you, these cunning stunts, and they can spawn cystoids that home in on you, radiate you, and block your shots. Not the most annoying enemy to fight, especially once you're out of zero G, but still fuckheaded. There's some good reinforcement situations for how far your glue gun can go here, and don't forget to raid all the boxes that say supplies on them in these little rest zones. But other than that, your main goal is to make it through to the Arboretum, and find out what's stopping the lifts.
Morgan, are you all right? That Typhon, there's nothing in the research. Stay away from it.
That right there was the nightmare. The biggest and most formidable threat on board the station with you. I love that thing. The Arboretum is to Talos One what Arcadia is to Rapture. Its gardens and plant life provide some oxygen and food production for the station. It's definitely one of the most wide open spaces on the station and, in my opinion, it's one of the most daunting, exploratory wise. Its pathways and overgrown shrubbery often hide an array of different enemies that can scatter easily between the different levels and obscuring foliage. It's also one of the most multi-branching areas in the game, as both a primary lift location and the hub for areas like the crew quarters and the bridge, plus the office slash penthouse of Alex, which by the way, you don't have one of those. You and your parents get private rooms in the crew quarters, but Alex has an LA home in space. How ostentatious is that? His crew come up here for a rest in the greenery, sit down on a bench, and they see his giant fucking postmodern architecture mansion right in the middle of the recreational area? That's like if a head teacher put their jacuzzi adorned office right in the middle of the staff room. Look at me, I make more than you, prick. Anyway, the easiest thing to do here is to investigate the disturbance with the lift.
Morgan, that Typhon is an unknown type. From what I can tell, it's the source of the problem with the lift.
A technopath. Why'd it have to be a technopath? Even more than weavers and cystoids, technopaths are bar none my least favorite enemy type in the game. Their placement's well designed, they're just annoying, especially if you're not playing with Typhon powers. As well as being able to control mechanical arsenals like operators and turrets, they can set off a high-ranged EMP blast which knocks out security tools like your glue cannon, your stun gun and your beam rifle, which would arguably be the most effective physical weapons to use against them. In a pinch, the only way to deal with these guys is to use an ability called Combat Focus, the only non-Typhon based ability you can learn, which adds a damage bonus and puts you in a slow motion state, and just pump the ever loving fuck out of them with a shotgun, but they're still highly resistant to shotgun blasts in the early game. Thankfully, being so non-linear, you can come back to this guy once you're stronger, but you won't be able to use the lift until you face this enemy, and regardless, technopaths will appear throughout the game from here on. I think this game does a really good job of escalation progression. The further you get into the story, the more types of enemies you discover. The more types of enemies you discover, the more they'll appear throughout and around the station. It gives this fantastic sense that while you're blasting your way through every enemy in sight, they're just growing more and more powerful. You're not actually winning against these things. A great visual technique used to indicate the spreading of the Typhon is the constant appearance of the golden filaments, which become more and more pervasive around the station the deeper into the story you get. It's terrifying, and works really well from a gameplay element, as you're more than likely getting individually stronger as the enemy does too. You're more equipped to deal with growing threats, but the threats are growing. This is why you need to destroy the station. That was one of our first real fights, and it's obvious if something stronger comes along, we're completely outmatched. So, in this version of events, we'll take the leap and install neuromods that give us the same abilities as the Typhon.
You're not what they say you are.
Rejecting the new cell lines, fighting them off like an antivirus.
Typhon powers are one of the biggest game changers between playthroughs. I've never leant very heavily into them, but I'll be doing so in this playthrough for variety's sake. You can unlock new ones by researching different types of Typhon and then installing them. Install enough of them, and protective material like turrets will start to view you as a threat, making them a new enemy type too. But they can act as a great evener for the playing field. For example, with the aforementioned telepath knocking out your electrical equipment, you can give them a taste of their own medicine and give them an electroshock, stunning their peripheral operators and paralyzing their ability to shock you for a short while. Plus the prime Typhon ability, Mimicry, becomes available, and it's so much fun. As far as I know, there are some small areas that simply aren't accessible without mimicking your way through. They're obviously not necessary areas and will never give you a massive reward, but you won't be able to access them at all on a non-Typhon playthrough. Anywho, having fixed the lift, we can move freely between the main lobby and the Arboretum. I recommend going back to your office to stock up and then coming back up to the Arboretum at this point for a spooky surprise. I'm not going to tell you what it is, but it's super fun. We can finally make it to our destination, Deep Storage, but we run into another major roadblock. The door is voice protected. It won't open without the vocal command of one crew member named Danielle Sho.
It's unlikely Chief Sho is still alive. I advise you follow Zachary West's strategy. Hack together voice samples. Your transcribe is equipped with the necessary software. It's how you made my voice. Danielle's cabin might be a good place to get started.
Crew quarters is only a short skip away. So far, we've been pretty linear in dealing with these areas, using them to get from one place to another. But in crew quarters, we'll have our work cut out for us. We already get an unfamiliar surprise upon entering. The sight of what seems like other humans alive on the station. Closer inspection through the psychoscope will show you these people are being mind controlled. By who, or what, we'll soon discover. You could take them out, and you're planning on blowing up the station anyway, but if you were a particularly altruistic person, and by altruistic I mean going for a pacifist achievement, you can instead knock them unconscious with a stun gun. You have to be very stealthy around these guys if you're going for a save all humans game, because if they notice you, they will gallop straight for you and suicide pop their heads when they get close.
Get out of my face, Regina!
Anyway, This area is one of my favourite designs. It's one of those that makes this environment feel like a real livable space. Each side room is unique and each one has a purpose within this place. Most of the major crew's VIP rooms are here, as well as shared bunks for the lowly peasants. There's also recreational areas to make this feel like a shared space, like a night lounge, cinema rooms and game rooms, and a cafeteria. As with all the areas, there's a lot to explore and a lot of dots to connect in the world building. On first entry, we hear a voice over the tannoy.
Stupid puppets. What? You too? You want to come into a kitchen? Good.
It's someone who refers to these mind control people as puppets and is clearly holed up in the nearby kitchen. There's multiple ways to acquire the voice imprints we need in this location, and there's a few creative ways other than just discarded transcribes.
Friday night.
In the nearby bar, the Yellow Tulip, we can find a pre-recording of Danielle Show's singing built into the performance system. Problem is, playing this over the tannoy will attract the attention of a small horde of phantoms. This is another example of the game rewarding learning through experience, like the game itself is a neuromod that teaches you through memory, as though your first playthrough was actually a reset. Remembering this moment on second playthrough, you can prepare for this assault better with nearby turrets. Just as an aside, I fucking love this song as well, the one that Danielle sings. It's just for this game, but it's an actual song, and it's catchy as fuck. Crew quarters is one of the best areas to exemplify how dense and lived in this station feels. Don't forget, this isn't just an FPS or an adventure game, it's a sim. It relies on making you feel in the moment, and that's best achieved by making this world feel real, and the people in it feel real too.
Hi Daddy, happy birthday! I made you a present, but you'll have to open it when you get home because your company has lame rules. I really miss you. Tell Mr. Yu I said kids should be allowed in space. Well, I guess that's all for now. I love you.
Moving on to the recreation area, we get a fantastic introduction to a new threat, and honestly, my favourite enemy type in the game. Poltergeist is invisible most of the time, and only barely noticeable when it's casting an ability. Its presence is always told by a unique ringing sound. Even when the poltergeist doesn't make a move, it really puts you on edge when you enter an area.
It was a spooky ghost!
They have a distinctive ability to lift you up into a vortex, but other than that, their ability to hinder you comes from their unknowability. Where they are? When will they strike? Where does their range extend to? They're just really fun to fight, and one of the tensest enemies to face off against. Despite being invisible, they dominate a room. But eventually, we take it out and move onwards to the cafeteria. It's filled with people, all mind-controlled, and the perpetrator of the mind control becomes apparent. A new enemy called a telepath. Much like the technopath, but working on biological elements. I do think the telepaths are stronger, but for this reason, I never considered them as big of a threat. There's very few remaining humans for the telepath to control, whereas the technopaths always travel with operators and turrets. That being said, on a pacifist run, this moment can give you one of the biggest challenges. You have to take out the telepath before it has a chance to send any of its victims on a suicide run towards you. If you're successful, all the humans will simply fall unconscious, released from its control. Now the threat in the kitchen has subsided, we can meet the person who was speaking over the tannoy earlier.
Your suit. What is in your name tag? You? M.U.?
M.U. You killed Bist yourself.
Ah.
If you want to come in, be safe. You go. Get something of mine, huh? Here, key. It opens my room. Go there. Get my... award. It's important to me.
The cook, Will Mitchell, wants us to retrieve his award from his room in the cabins. So let's head there. Along the way, we'll find more audio recordings of Danielle's show. She's often in conversation with someone called Abigail Foy, and through scattered conversations, it doesn't take long to surmise that Abigail and Danielle were in a relationship. A complicated one, but a loving one, nonetheless. You have a chance here to explore more of the crew's homes away from home. For example, the cabin of Lorenzo Calvino, the lead technician behind the looking glass technology that we searched down earlier. He has a prototype looking glass in his room, which I think is a really cool detail. In his diary logs, it's apparent that Calvino suffers from a mental illness, some kind of memory degradation, and mentions the memory of meeting his wife on the coast of Amalfi, and, in another wonderful detail, the landscape that he's constructed in his prototype looking glass is that same Amalfi coast. It's touching, and shows that the people on this station aren't just all random footmen like in most games with labs or infrastructures. They're real people, with histories and problems. Finally, in the cook's room, the award is there, and a transcribe.
What the hell did you do to that thing, Mitchell? Sounds like an anti-waffle commercial.
Well, I didn't see it as an override per se. It was just the operator's conversation sequencer. They're usually so grim.
Curious. This is supposedly Will Mitchell. Do these look like the same person to you? The cook lets us into his kitchen and points us to the freezer, where we can gather some supplies.
Transdown, piece of junk. Are you awake, M.U.? Frozen dead, maybe? I take Puppet's story screen. I see all the names in the list. And your name, too. Means you listen from now on. I know who you are, M.U. Daughter of William U. William. Transtar. Always playing with lies. Now. Maybe I watch these beasts eat you, like you tried to feed me to them.
We've been trapped.
I'm in a glass case of emotion!
Very Bioshock, by the way. This wasn't Will Mitchell. We still don't know who it is, but they know who we are, and they mention we tried to feed them to the Typhon? What could that mean? Nearby, we find the body of Danielle's partner, Abigail Foy, with a final message sent by Danielle instructing her to head to the fitness center, and bang on the window. There's a way out of the freezer here, and I actually only noticed that you could melt the ice with this pipe on this playthrough. I've always been trying to do ability shit like heavy lift the block or throw a recycler charge. I really need to get better at using my environment. The cook's gone by the time we escape back into the kitchen, but he still tries to trick us with a recycler charge on the fucking door. I hate this mechanic, but only because I'm super salty whenever I fall for it. You'll find these recycler traps interspersed at random doorways and operation terminals throughout the station from here on, and if you don't notice what's happening fast enough, it's usually a death sentence, full health or not. I'm not falling for it this time.
Morgan, that massive Typhon appeared shortly after you installed alien neuromods. You're being hunted. I warned you.
Oh, that giant nightmare found me. That's great. No, that's good. Good timing. Just what I need. Great. Fuck! I've never tried a no neuromod run, but I'd be interested to see if January says anything different here. Or if the nightmare hunts you at all, considering she suggests it only hunts you based off your neuromod installation. You can hide out or fight the nightmare whenever it shows up. It's terrifying, but unfortunately, its AI often ruins the encounter. It's so big that there's only designated spots in each area that it can go, often with cheap spots to cheese the fight from, and the nightmare has real difficulty moving around in them. Really, only an area like the Arboretum or the Cargo Bay are big enough to get a proper fight out of the thing. It's tough to take down when it's an actual fight, but with bullets and cover that the creature wasn't designed to compensate against, it's usually just a cheap source for Typhon material. The last major area in crew quarters is the fitness center. Softly making our way through wandering puppets, we'll make it to their master, a telepath in the pool area. Once we've cleared it out, we can follow Danielle's instructions and bang on the window.
Morgan? If you're here, then Abby didn't make it, did she? I don't... Nothing more that I can do for you right now. But look, be careful. There's someone else in crew quarters pretending to be the cook. His tracking bracelet's from Psychotronics, but the ID doesn't make any sense. I think he's the one that killed Abby. If you can, make sure he doesn't get off the station. I'll see what else I can do to help from out here. For as long as I can. Goodbye, Morgan.
Danielle's alive, for now. And if you haven't got all the voice notes synthesized yet, this'll do it. So it's finally time to head to deep storage. No more blockades, no more distractions.
Voice identification required. Please repeat the following words. Gravity, corkscrew, proclivity, narrowness.
Gravity, corkscrew, proclivity, erroneous.
As soon as we enter deep storage, Alex puts us on lockdown, claiming that it's for our own good and that he's on our side. Never heard that from a villain before, I reckon. We can make our way to Danielle Show's office and, interestingly, find an email she'd sent Alex referring to her suspicions of an unlicensed operator built by Morgan, most likely being January in her earliest ages. But mainly we're here to grab the plans for that arming key of ours. The central repository is infested with cystoid nests, the culprit of their creation being a weaver that prowls through the vaults. In zero gravity, it's just annoying having to deal with so many cystoids at once, and weavers have the ability to disorient you in a fight, making this area kind of a chore to clear out. The place is also riddled with explosive canisters, which is a weird thing to hoard in a bunch of data vaults and could surely only lead to disaster. We eventually find the backup drive and mount it to a server, meaning we can now acquire one of those arming keys. All well and good, but one major roadblock, Alex still has us locked down in deep storage. Thankfully, Danielle comes to our rescue. She tells us we're able to manually jettison one of the data vaults off into space, taking us with it. Once we're off the station, we can work on finding another way back in order to fulfill her request of killing the pseudo-cook. So bypassing the internal computer systems that Alex is in control of, we turn ourselves into space junk.
Nothing that interferes with memory formation.
That was weird. I won't hide it. The game pulls a lot of the same stuff that Bioshock did, plot-wise, including the random cryptic flashes to hints of another story. And if you played Bioshock, this will instantly give you the inclination that something else is going on that we aren't quite aware of yet. The game's building up to a twist. Unfortunately, I don't think this game handles it as cleverly or nuanced as Bioshock did, and it's pretty easy to guess the twist as you go. Although, to be fair, this is a game whose story deals with cerebral mentality, so tries about 6 twists by the end. One of them's bound to get you a bit on first go through. When we come to, we're off station again, and almost immediately contacted by Sarah Elazar, Chief Security Officer, who directs us to Cargo Bay, where a lot of the survivors are holed up. The docking stations there aren't necessarily airlocks or personnel access routes, so we should be able to get back on board from there. As we approach Cargo Bay, we find we're not the only ones stranded outside the station.
This is Dr. Dayo Igwe. I'm broadcasting to all contacts in proximity. Please, whoever is out there, listen to me. Oxygen is low and I have no spacesuit. An accident in Cargo Bay forced me to seal myself inside this container. But I have no way to dock with the station from in here.
You can take no action, abandon Igwe and leave him to die. You can take immediate action to open his container and kill him quickly. Or you can go through the rigmarole of docking his container back onto the cargo bay and save his life.
Whoa, it's like a choice parallel to the test at the beginning. It's like a theme or something, man.
Well, we went the long way around to save lives in the crew quarters. So what's one more life to save? That's what any good human would do, right? With Igwe safely inside, we can follow behind through his shipping container and get back on board Talos 1 through the cargo bay. I really like the cargo bay. When we enter, it's dark and infested with phantoms. Many of the survivors are hauled up in the offices upstairs, and while we can reach them by making our way up vertically to the catwalks, we'll need to clear the area and restart the power to make the area safe enough for the main door to open. Once all that's done, we can meet the surviving crew of Talos 1, including the doctor we saved from the container, Dio Igwe, who worked closely with us and our brother prior to our memory wipe. More importantly, we meet Security Chief Sarah Elazar, who we've heard sending out signals throughout our journey so far. I think one of the weakest elements of this game is character modelling. Although a lot of them have a distinct Dishonored-esque style which sets them apart from bland models in other games, there's something a little bit off about the way the final product looks, and Elazar in particular looks pretty bad. I don't know if it's the lighting or what, but she looks bumpy and plastic. But I suppose you don't bump into too many living people on the station, so it's not that much of a problem.
All we need is the turret fabricator plan. There's one in the safe in the security office, but the hull breach puts it out of my reach. Still, if you have a suit and are up for another walk, we could really use the additional firepower.
We have two options here. We can spacewalk to the hull breach and fight our way to a turret fabrication plan, or go puzzle-solving our way around cargo bay to find pre-made ones. Another gameplay route I never really go is crafting turrets and using them to secure areas you plan to revisit. Basically a techie run, but you could totally do that. Elazar has one more important thing to say before we leave for our task.
Look, I don't know what you're planning, Morgan, but just remember, the only thing that matters is how you treat the people that are still alive.
This game never lets up on reminding us of its core theme of humanity. It's really easy nowadays to just slip a nebulous, stat-centric morality system into a game without it playing much of a part on the story or your decisions during gameplay. But in Prey, the writers never forget what the character is capable of, what the world is there for. You have to make decisions based off saving lives, ending them, or through inactivity, allowing them to run their course. Your very first impactful moment during gameplay is a morality test, halted from its resolution thanks to the Typhon interference. Now, you have a chance to push through that interference and take that morality test to its conclusion through your real-world actions. Morality isn't just a second system in this game, it is the game. And the writers were savvy enough to not let it fall into the background. Every major character who either liked you or didn't like you before your memory wipe will judge you based off what you do for them now. For everyone. We set up our defences for the cargo bay doors, remembering that I'm absolutely radiant with Typhonades and need to hack every single turret so they don't riddle me with bullets as well. Once ready, it's time to roll the dice and open up the doors. I really enjoy this moment. It's a good time to get a bunch of psychoscope scans for one thing, but it's also a nice action set piece within an otherwise horror and stealth based game. It's very Aliens. Once the crew and the turrets work their magic, you have access to the other side of Cargo Bay. It's a great place to stock up on extra items, and with the turrets online, the survivors can hold out here indefinitely, and we can work on making our way back up to the station through life support. Upon entering the department, we're contacted by one Michaela Ilyushin.
I didn't think to check your transcribe. Not sure how you got here. I thought you left because... Never mind. Airlocks and lifts are locked up. Like my lungs.
She's having trouble speaking to us, explaining it's because of a condition called paraplexus that's seizing her lungs, but she has a plan to reverse the director level lockdown. By reaching the power plant through life support, we can reboot the station's main reactor and reset the security restrictions, loosening the doors and the airlocks again. I did notice at this point that it's weird we were able to get into life support in the first place. I mean, sure, we could get in and out through the cargo docks to the exterior because they're not technically personnel entrances and exits, but weren't the area's security doors supposed to be locked down? Why wasn't the door between the cargo bay and life support in lockdown? It was very convenient for gameplay, I mean, for Morgan. Oh, fuck you, game.
Just off from this lift, there's this walkway that you can just about get under, and there's a little hidden stash of bullets and heal items there. Now that's just a little secret between you and me. Most major sections of the station have an escape pod area, and while this game has a few ways to make an unconventional ending, just up and leaving in one of these pods isn't one of them. You'll get a malfunction message every time, and we'll soon find out why. Multiple emails and conversation logs in this area seem to center around one person, a Price Broadway, and it doesn't take long to discern that Price had a big problem with drinking, even to the point of working while intoxicated. We're tasked with finding Price, or at least what's left of him. He's supposed to be confined in crew quarters, but let's have a look around. We make our way down to the water treatment plant, where eels are harvested for a main food source on the station, and where Price is originally supposed to be stationed. It seems, in his intoxicated state, Price took a tumble into the eel tank and perished. A reminder that, whether through meddling with the Typhon or through other personal factors, it's vices, hubris, and other human flaws that led to the downfall of the people on this station. Beyond life support, we can make our way to the power plant, in search of Michaela Ilyushin. The power plant is probably my least favourite area in the game. It's sometimes a chore to get through, some of the rooms aren't as fun to explore, and it doesn't offer as many cool, unique moments as other locations. For example, this room, flooded by electrified water, is my least favourite in the game. It's a good way to help reinforce optional traversability, but even once you fully explore the room, even when you fix the power conductor, there's no way to turn the electricity off. There's a poltergeist in this room that seems to kill me at least once every time, because you have such little space to fight it. There's nothing even particularly interesting in this room, save for a couple of emails. Remember not long ago when we tried using the escape pods and they didn't work? Well, get this. Emanuela, I'm not supposed to tell anyone about this, but I wanted you to know since you're someone I really care about. The escape pods don't work. If there's ever an emergency on the station, don't try using them. However, I'm working on rigging one of them to work. Don't tell anyone. Frank. You'll notice it's signed to Emanuela, but he sent it to one Emmanuel Mendez, and in response, Frank doubles his email with a follow-up. Emmanuel, it looks like I sent you an email by accident. Just ignore it, please. Also, what I wrote in the email was just a joke. I was pranking somebody. Uh-oh. Scandalous! I do like this. The escape pods don't just not work because the game designers were like, shit, space stations have escape pods, but we want to keep them in the game. Error message? This gives real in-world recognition that that method of escape doesn't exist, and it does get extended upon through further information about Frank and his work that you'll find through this station. We make our way down to the coolant chamber, another dorky ass room that's filled with dorks. Look at this dork! No! And another one. This dork will never date the captain of the cheerleading squad. Sorry, I'm just trying to make this room fun because I find it kind of tedious to get through. Beyond it though, we find Michaela, and she's in pretty bad shape.
I get up, except for my legs, and my lungs, and my nervous system. Don't look surprised. Paraplexus, remember? You warned me. The boosters are in my office. No way I'm getting there now. But the lifts. I was serious before. I think we can bypass the lockdown. The reactor control room. There's a panel for shutting down everything. The whole station. The computer will scream at you, but just do it. Then pray it all comes back when you cycle the power. It should. It will.
We're tasked with helping Michaela by recovering the medicine she needs from her office, now accessible only through a hull breach outside. We still can't get out there, so first things first, down to the reactor to make that restart. Oh god in all damnations! I really like the nightmare encounters actually. However, I will say I have noticed a pattern where with every new save game, it seems to prioritize one area over any other. On one save it was the cargo bay, on another it was the Arboretum. I would say on this playthrough, it was in the power plant pretty much every single time I went there, and it's really not a great place to fight the nightmare.
There's very little cover on the catwalks from its AoE attacks, and again, this thing really only works in large open spaces, and even then it struggles. We're in the reactor controls. This is a fun little sequence where everything reboots one by one. When the gravity goes off, everything in the room starts to float. But when this is completed, two technopaths spawn in. Suck my space-bound disposable dick, two technopaths. What's worse, they manage to retrieve turrets from behind a locked cage door. Besides recycler traps, I've not really found a good way to prepare for this fight prior to initiating their entrance, as with other pre-predicted ambush encounters. You just gotta take them down. We get an absolute onslaught of character updates over our transcribe while we're trying to deal with this. Michaela, Sarah, Alex, people giving us tips, people giving us new missions. Are you autistic like me? Yeah? Well, good luck with the audio sensory overwhelm. This links to probably my biggest issue with the game that I want to talk about more later in terms of what it does to the experience. But for now, let me just say, if the game didn't give me a big mission log prompt telling me to go to Alex's office, I would have completely missed hearing him telling me to do it amid the other stuff I have to focus on. Working our way back up to Michaela, she tells us the plan worked. Everything's opened back up. Before her death, she feels she's done something worthwhile to help. She expects us to head straight to the lift. But Michaela isn't just another crew member on board. We've actually been in a relationship with her before we lost our memory. The relationship didn't last. She made her way on board, hiding her paralyzing medical condition, knowing she wouldn't be able to work on Talos 1 if people knew about it. And when Morgan found out, despite it being against protocol, we kept it hidden. There are, or at least before the memory wipe, were residual feelings there. But we have more reason than with anyone else on board to try and save her life. You don't have to, but in this instance, we make our way to the exterior and retrieve her medicine from her office.
You surprise the hell out of me sometimes. Please, right at the neck. Just look for the marks. It was harder when I was doing it myself. Oh God, I can breathe again. And feel my legs.
Now she's well enough to move, Michaela will make her own way to the safety of our office in the lobby. So this is a bit of a random anecdotal aside, but I was recently binge-watching a 90s TV show called Beakman's World, which is something I do every now and again with old kids' shows because nostalgic, existential distraction is kind of my vibe. Anyway, I noticed that they switched out Beakman's lab assistant in season 2 for a new girl, and my immediate thought was, you can't do that. Right? I love Josie. Josie's awesome. Josie was Frank's pretty woman. But I immediately forgave them because Liza is astonishingly attractive and I developed a belated crush within the first 5 seconds. Anyway, I chased the trail, as it were, to Beakman's IMDb page to find out what the deal with the switch out was. And I ended up on the actress's IMDb page, Eliza Schneider, who played Liza in season 2. And it turned out by total coincidence that she's a very prolific voice actress who voiced Michaela Ilyushin in Prey. I had been watching Beakman's World and editing my Prey video at the exact same time without any idea that they were linked. Great games, 90s media, gorgeous women, all my interests come full circle. The coolant chamber we passed through has been flooded with a hydrogen gas leak in the reactor shakeup. One shot from a standard weapon and the whole room goes up. Now I didn't know this until this playthrough because I usually just blast to the other end of this room, but you can in fact repair these tanks to reseal the hydrogen and reduce the gas leak in this room. It reminds me a lot of repairing the reactors on the Aurora in Subnautica. Anyway. Let's make our way back to the lift.
Stupid fucking imposter chef, fuck you, you bitch, I'm gonna find you and fuck you, you piece of—
Igwe and Michaela have made their way back to our office. They don't get on. One is deeply invested in the Typhon Neuromod research, and one is heavily against its perverse nature. One is incredibly self-preserving, while the other is humanitarily driven. In a private moment, Michaela explains to us why she lied about her condition to get on board. Her father, a naysayer of a Siberian invasion on India, was imprisoned purely for speaking out against this injustice, then recruited into Transtar's volunteer program. Most people recruited into the program are prisoners, whose only choices are to act as guinea pigs for Transtar or face death. Whether legitimate criminals or unjustly jailed, as with Michaela's father, the program plays fast and loose with the word volunteer. She came on board to try and find her father, and asked us to head to deep storage in order to recover his archived records, to discover what happened to him. Igwe also asks us to run a personal, sentimental errand. In his room in crew quarters, he keeps the neural record of the skills of a famous pianist who visited the station, and whom he holds in incredibly high regard. This pianist, like all aboard, died in the outbreak, but his skills live on in this record, this connectome. Igwe wants us to retrieve the connectome so those skills aren't lost. Another detour to add to the list. Don't forget, we plan to blow up this entire station with no way for anyone off it. Barely any of this would matter. But these tasks, uncovering information for Michaela, avenging Danielle, saving Igwe's sentimental possessions, it gives these people closure, lets them die with dignity. These priorities, desires, and impulses are rooted in the human condition. Wonder, aggression, art, respect, family, love. And in empathizing with those priorities, we recover a bit of our own humanity in the process, in repentance for whoever we were and whatever we did before our memory was wiped, before we became a different Morgan. Okay, so as with most RPGs, there are many ways to play and structure is very much up in the air. Are you the kind of player that rushes through the main story as soon as possible and then does all the little side things after the credits roll? Or are you the kind of player that hits up every encounter and side quest as soon as it pops up? That kind of structure. This has a huge, huge effect on gameplay impression and interest longevity as well, because the game needs to be equally as fun when you rush through the main story without much leveling up or weapon acquisition, and equally as fun if you decide to rinse every side quest or upgrade or corner of the world the second it comes to you, rendering the game so easy that it ceases to be a cakewalk and turns into a goddamn muffin marathon. I bring this up because I'm the kind of player that unlocks all areas and discoverables to an allowable or manageable degree, continue with the main story for a bit, and then when it feels like that story is coming to a comfortable break or reaching a penultimate point, I absolutely rinse all the side stuff that's available in the world so that when I do hit that final point in the story, the credits roll feels like a final credits roll. I call it the cleanup, and it's time to do it here. I really like doing the cleanup in my playthroughs through Sunset Overdrive and Skyrim and Tombi. By the way, I can't believe I brought up Tombi twice in a Prey review. All the side quests and the optional areas usually add the most lore building to a game and are the things that make me feel the most immersed in it. And Prey's got some great examples of that that I want to delve into here. So before we head off to Alex's office for that elusive second arming key, we've got some unfinished business to take care of around Talos 1. First, we make the perilous trek back to the crew quarters for the pianist's connectomes for Igwe. He's eternally grateful and pours over his love for the pianist to the point of admitting that he used a neuromod to learn the concerto himself. This reinforces Igwe's positive stance on the neuromod research. The pianist, Leitner, is dead, but with neuromods, his skills now live on through Igwe. He fails to realise the irony that the cause of Leitner's death, the Typhon, are the origins of neuromods in the first place. Next, we head over to deep storage to recover the records of Michaela's father and find out what happened to him. The records do not paint a pretty picture, especially of Morgan, as it turns out we were the ones there, ordering the experimentation on her father. We'd just forgotten.
Look at me. Look at the man you're killing.
Mimic is in the tube.
Permission to release? Morgan?
What you do kills us both.
Release.
Now, the remark that the cook made earlier about us trying to feed him to the Typhon makes sense, as he turns out to be a volunteer as well. We, or at least the old Morgan, showed no humanity towards these volunteers. We can either erase this data to save face, tell Michaela the records were destroyed among the station's damage and forego any bad blood by lying to her, or we can send her the file. It's a hard truth to swallow, hearing her father tortured and us as the ones who signed the dotted line, but it is the truth nonetheless. It's the hard option, but it's the human option. So we send it to her. She's waiting in our office for us to listen to it together. Okay, this is getting heavy. Look, I'm a can! Kick me!
Whee!
On our way back through the Arboretum, we hear voices coming from a nearby structure, a towering greenhouse overlooking the area. Calls for help. Upon investigation, we find humans trapped inside, being mind-controlled by a telepath. If you want to save them by releasing the monster's control, you can make your way up onto the roof and get the drop on it. Another survivor had safely locked herself in a storage room, Rani, and now she's safe, she can make her way down to Cargo Bay with the rest of the survivors. This greenhouse is a good place to stock up on food consumables, if that's your favoured method of healing. Speaking of food, I shoot my way through the guts like a turd through, well, the guts, and make my way back to Psychotronics to get to the lobby and... You're still here? Dude, this is Psychotronics. That's like standing on the volcano's edge at Pom fucking Pei. Ground Zero, man. Good Cargo Bay or something. Although he does tell us something interesting. He saw another volunteer make his way through the area before us, who didn't let him out, reminding us that the killer cook is still loose on the station, and we have a promise to keep to Danielle's show. But we will make our way back to our office for a reason. It's time to take the dive and let Michaela hear the truth.
Why would you save me to do this? To buy back some guilt? So I'd forgive you? My father is right. You don't understand. Your father, mother, your stupid, deluded brother. You will never understand family. You don't even understand what it means to be human. Get the hell away from me.
Michaela's gonna need some time alone. Igwe, on the other hand, just really likes this tree. Kind of moment killing. Thanks, Dio. I took some time here to explore optional areas and rooms, and after a short while, Michaela calms down and comes to a realization.
Morgan, January was right. It was not you. But I keep hearing your voice and my father's voice. And it was not you. I know. You saved me because you wanted to. That is not the same person on that recording. Something's changed. I need to see that. I'm better now. I'll do what I can to get us off the station alive, but that log is coming with me. If you truly want forgiveness, you'll help me get it to where it belongs, no matter what that means for you.
We're a different Morgan than when we first started our research. Even January, who was programmed once our humanitary conscience kicked in, has been surprised by some of our empathetic actions. But physically, we're still the one responsible, and if we want to show that change, we'll have to take that responsibility and be held accountable for our crimes, when or even if we ever reach Earth. For now, Michaela's on our side. Her goal to find out what happened to her father has been resolved. We continue searching every nook and cranny of the station. I wanted to talk about this area specifically because it's one of my favourites and I just dropped into it. Literally. Volunteer testing.
You sure about that?
It's a completely dark room in the Neuromod Division. There have been dark areas before, but usually with some kind of light compensation and with the power switch pretty easy to reach. Here, the switch is at the back of a pitch black room, and in trying to activate it, the area outside becomes completely electrified, so you either have to plan accordingly or go dark. As soon as you enter the department, the music unsettles you. This is tense as fuck. A true horror set piece within an already brilliant horror game. It feels very much like Alien or The Thing. What's great is for a while at first, nothing happens. The music made me certain a poltergeist was going to pop up, and having played before, I know one does. But I swear it's on some kind of timer. Sometimes it comes straight away, sometimes it comes after the power's activated, and sometimes it doesn't come at all. You're just left with the tension. It's brilliant, and as far as the game's atmosphere goes, easily my favourite room. But we're here for a specific reason, to track down our rogue volunteer. There's only one left on record whose heart is still beating. It has to be him, and he's located in an area we haven't yet explored, the bridge. The bridge comes into play much later in the story, and if you're focusing on the main plot, it's very probably the last area you'll visit. But before then, there's still things to do around the Neuromod Division. The ability to craft neuromods is potentially game-breaking, turning you from a desperate survivor into a powerful contender even against the Nightmare. To compensate for early gameplay overleveling, there's an early quest that activates wherein your license for crafting the neuromod runs out after so many have been fabricated. The only way to get this fabrication back is to head to the division director's office and reset the licenses. You can find the keycard to his office not too far away, on this poor sucker's ragdoll. The director, Holden Graves, is an interesting figure. Paying attention to the emails, transcribes, and even the set decoration here, you can piece together that while Haldon was in charge of fabricating the neuromods, he wasn't clued into where the exotic material used to craft them was coming from, the Typhon. He became increasingly inquisitive about this, and when he realized that the source was from extraterrestrial aliens, he killed himself, knowing that he'd helped to inject alien entities into humans. You can find the scissors he used to do it next to his body. But anyway, fuck this dude. We can make infinite neuromods now. It's OP time!
You like neuromods, eh? Well, have all the neuromods in the world!
Now we're really prepared for anything that we might come across. Are you having a fucking game of badminton, mate? Get the face out of my fork. I love saving up all my skill points and then leveling up a lot in one go. I love feeling that massive difference between struggle and relief. It's like getting a blowjob from a game designer. That's the dream, baby! While we're in Neuromod Division, remember the Neuromod chair from the beginning of the game? Well, there was a whiteboard next to that chair with a code smudged out. Well, pay attention during that first video of your previous self, and it was recorded before that message was erased. You won't get a quest for this. The only way to do this and complete many of the other environmental puzzles like it is to pay attention to the game, to the world around you. This is my absolute favourite kind of puzzle solving, and I'm not always smart enough to notice it, but it's so immersive. And after all, isn't that the point of an immersive sim? There's no pop-up, there's no arrow, there's no hints clogging up your HUD, there's just logical sense. From here, it's finally time to make our way over to the bridge. While not super important to the main plot, contextually there's a lot going on here. It's where the captain resides, and there's an incredibly interesting side quest. Reading the captain's station, you'll find an email addressed to her. Captain Marks, before it's too late, I thought you needed to know that the shuttle Advent departed just before the first alarms. They did go through standard inspection, but that was before we knew what to look for. If they land in Seattle with one of those things aboard, I've enabled the scuttle charges on the Advent. They can be activated remotely from the bridge. It's in your hands, Captain. They will touch down soon. For what it's worth, they have no idea the scuttle charges are enabled. Drew Springer. It's a heavy burden to bear. Captain Marks has to decide whether or not to blow the ship along with the people on board without definitive proof that they've been compromised by the Typhon. She may be ending completely innocent lives. Not far away, we find out what the captain's decision was. She couldn't make the call and instead ended her own life. Along with all the weaknesses of humanity that have claimed the people on board the station, vices, hubris, crime, obsession. The captain fell prey, to their one biggest weakness, humanity itself. The feeling of empathy towards others. She would have rather took her own life than potentially end the lives of her crew, whether for the greater good or not. Now, that decision falls to us. We have a limited window before the Advent lands on Earth. Our whole task has been to blow this station to stop the Typhon from spreading to Earth. Even one small containment breach could be worse for the entire human population in the face of a few casualties. But what are we forfeiting by making this choice? Are you responsible for the lives of others through inaction? And if not, is it worse to then involve yourself through activity to end the lives of a few for the benefit of the many? Would you pull the switch to make a train hit one person or walk away from the switch as it barrels towards 10 people. We walk away. This Morgan, this new Morgan, has spared life for every possibility, regardless of the risk. We're not killing volunteers for results and recklessly prioritizing neuromod development anymore. Everything we've done has been to preserve the humans on board and the ethics that distinguish them from the Typhon. That's what we have that they don't. Empathy. The Advent might have mimics on board, but there's an equal chance that they don't. In this perilous situation we find ourselves in. Let's be optimistic for once. And hey, since you've made it so far into the video, thank you so much for that, by the way. Let me give you a little tip, especially for all you weapon heads. Check the transcribes here and they'll give you a quest to retrieve a golden gun from Captain Mark's cabin. I don't know if it's any more powerful than the average pistol, but once it's fully upgraded, it's usually my weapon of choice. It's accurate, it's fast firing, and probably the most important thing about anything ever in the world, it looks good. Like me. We have one more piece of unfinished business to take care of. The killer cook is in here somewhere. Heading down to the local escape pods, you'll find him waiting. More than likely, he's discovered that the escape pods don't work, realized that he's screwed and stuck on board with us, and made his last stand here, as he's rigged himself with a recycler charge. Get too close and he'll detonate it, taking you both out. You can knock him unconscious to disable it, but the quest isn't complete until you kill him. That's what Danielle asked you to do, to avenge Abigail. The quest completes without a word from Danielle. No thank you or reward waiting anywhere. Presumably she's already perished, low on oxygen out of the station. It's a bittersweet conclusion to the storyline, but in the end, everyone on this station met an abrupt and unfair end. At least here, a maniac was stopped. That's the best we could have hoped for, I suppose. In honor of Abigail and Danielle, there's another little side quest you can complete, a treasure hunt. Around the station, you'll find the D&D character sheets and treasure maps of a campaign group that the two belong to. Following the maps will lead you to numbers linked to each character, and, once you've found all the numbers, they'll make a code to unlock some loot in Abigail's room in crew quarters, including a pretty amazing suit upgrade you can install. There are at least a good dozen other missions, hunts, mysteries, and histories for you to uncover aboard, but I just wanted to highlight some of the diversity that can be found in the side quests, and also highlight how much they affect the relationships and the substance of the people that lived and worked on this fallen station. Having explored it fairly well, we'll now make our way up to Alex's office in the Arboretum for that second arming key. Before we diverge away from the secondary quest lines, there's one you can continue in this office, one that was, potentially, one of the first side quests started. Early in our journey, we were contacted by a mysterious figure called December. Going off the naming schemes, this was no doubt an early model of January, with each monthly named iteration of these constructs being a different record of Morgan's state of mind. This Morgan, this December Morgan, was concerned with self-preservation. Following the quest path, it leads us to a hidden safe in Alex's office, with the key to a private escape pod above his office. Transcribes also point to a second key hidden on top of the data tower near the Neuromod chair, but when we find it, it's obvious Alex has already found it too, and confiscated it. You can actually reach the escape pod earlier using your glue cannon, but without the keycard, there's no way to open it. Now, we can. Both Alex and January call you out if you start the process of taking the coward's exit, about the only thing they agree on. It's just a little funny side ending, an abrupt end to the story. Fuck it, why not? Let's tap out. I'm tired. With all that wrapped up, Alex is ready to cooperate. All we have to do first is watch a video in his office. He gives us the password to his computer. Interestingly, it's Chen Huang Shen. Chen Huang was a city god, a deity of walls and a protector of the people held within those walls. This is who Alex sees himself as. Earth is the people. This station is the wall that protects them from the threats outside, the Typhon, and he is the overseer of that wall. It's God.
You moved my chair without touching it. Gave me chills. The possibilities. You became something new that day. Something higher. I knew then, as I believe now, that our mission is to lift up all humanity in the same way.
Beyond the passcode, we can watch the video that Alex is so desperate for us to see, and it changes everything.
My name is Morgan Yu. Year is 2035. I'm aboard the Talos 1 research facility. What else?
Why are we making this video?
Right. Because my big brother is paranoid. Psychometric data is showing statistically significant variance in personality patterns between trial runs of the new neuromods. Whatever. I feel more like myself than ever. I mean, look at this. We did it, Alex. It's real.
Enjoy it while you can, because in a few minutes, it'll all be gone when we strip out the neuromods and reset.
I know, including my memory of it.
No way around it. Let's talk about the backup.
So, the Typhon organisms have been producing an elaborate structure. Material is unknown, purpose unknown. My gut tells me it's kind of a neural framework, but externalized. Still waiting on analysis to confirm. In the meantime, I've given Alex the design for a device I think could shut it down, if it ever broke containment. Alex just has to grow a pair and commit.
You don't have to take all the credit. What if it doesn't work?
It'll work. Trust me. What else are we going to do? Blow everything up? That won't save us.
And if it does work, is it worth it?
The people that come after us will be smarter, stronger, immortal. They can judge us if they want. But they'll know they exist because of the things we did. I'm ready. Do it.
Well, there you have it. Everything I've done is what you've asked me to do. I didn't think you'd believe me unless you heard it from your own mouth. The tests, they changed you. Not a lot at first, but eventually, the constant stripping of your memory. I didn't know who you were anymore. All I want is to have my sister back so we can finish what we started. The device you mentioned, it's an advanced version of the null wave. It's the only way to stop the Typhon without destroying everything we've been working toward. We're just missing some scan data from the Coral to complete the design. Help me finish this, Morgan. And then, you can have my arming key. I don't believe you want to use it anymore, but you can have it. I left a chip set for you on my desk. You'll need to upgrade your psychoscope to scan the Coral. I'll send you the scan locations.
The reason Alex has been fighting so hard to save the station is because we told him to. It may not be the Morgan that we are anymore, but what would we expect? That was the original Morgan, the one he grew up with. In his mind, his real sister, and it makes more sense that our actions now aren't those of our authentic self to him, influenced by the tests and the Typhon contamination from the neuromods. You may agree with Alex and seek to save the station from here on. You may stick by your guns and, in this new mindset, still believe the station should be destroyed. But either way, we now know why Alex was doing everything he was doing. That's a good antagonist design right there.
I've been thinking about the video Alex showed you. Your brother believes that version of you is the true Morgan. But why? Just because it came first? If someone had made you, then I suppose your truest self would be the one that fulfills whatever purpose your maker intended. I know who made me, and why. Did someone make you, Morgan? Were you made for something? If not, you'll have to invent your own purpose, or have none at all. Strangely, of all the things I know about you, I don't know what you believe. You have to decide, Morgan. Who are you?
Regardless of if you want to save the station, you still need to scan the Coral nodes and collect the data needed to build the prototype null wave that can take out the Typhon. Only then will he entrust us with his arming key. With both the null wave in one hand and the arming keys in the other, his hope is that you'll come to realize which is the better option. Alex believes the first Morgan to be the truest one. January believes it to be the newest one. It's an interesting thought experiment into who we are and what makes us. How much our foundations make our core beings, or whether our personal development counts for more. Getting to the Coral nodes is a gauntlet of weavers and cystoids in zero gravity. I hate this shit.
You'd better do something. The reconstruction is destabilizing.
They're lying to you.
Hurry.
More scrambled flashes from the obvious plot twist, I mean, the fractured memories. When we get back to Alex's office, we can upload the coral data, but our progress is interrupted. Something, or someone, has interfered with the upload.
This is Commander Walter Dahl. The TransStar Board of Directors has authorized me to take full command of Talos One. Effective immediately. All employees must now report to the Shuttle Bay for evacuation. Those of you unable to comply, transmit an SOS and my team of rescue operators will locate you. One last thing. Alex and Morgan Yu have been relieved of their positions. Do not consent to their requests or assist them in any way. Dahl out.
This Dahl is about to launch an assault against us, but thankfully, I've played this game before and thought ahead. Recycler traps, bitch! These are Dahl's military operators, and they're a really, really, really good reason to do your side quest cleanup before you hit Alex's office, because they're strong, they can endlessly respawn operator terminals, and they will run through your resources like a motherfucker. Dahl is locking us out from his command shuttle, so our next step is to get into it. This is probably my least favourite part of the game. On top of every other obstacle we've hit to retrieve the arming keys, this one just feels like such an exhausting roadblock. There is a reason for Dahl to be on the station, we'll get to that in a second, but it's such a distraction, and these operators are a menace. It actually makes you glad of the Typhon to have them chip away at these things first, before you interfere in a firefight. We get a quest to deactivate our own tracking bracelet so they can't actively track us down, but they become so prevalent on board the station, they'll notice you while you're wandering around the area anyway. We even get giga ambushed by these things coming out of deep storage after the deactivation, so what the fuck? That being said, if your main weapon of choice is the Q-beam, they are a great never-ending source of ammunition. Igwe feels he might have a beneficial solution to our problem with Dahl, so let's go hear him out.
You see, Dahl's mods are early C-series betas and vulnerable. As such, he has old-school thinking on some matters. If we remove them, he may forget his mission here, yet we would still have access to the shuttle and a way home, provided his piloting knowledge remains intact. It's a risk, but worth taking, I think.
If we can get to Dahl without killing him and strip out his neuromods, he can forget his mission to kill us and act as a pilot on his shuttle to take all the survivors we've rescued off the station. Depending on your moral conclusions, this might pose a problem. You were originally tasked with blowing up the station and everyone on board to erase any risk of an outbreak beyond its walls. If you blew up the Advent to ensure this is achieved, you may be compelled to do away with this plan. Kill Dahl anyway, and go ahead with your previous two options. After all, why risk a second containment breach on board a shuttle? But here, we saved the Advent. This Morgan,
my Morgan, yeah,
refused to take life if it wasn't necessary. Why go through the effort to save all these lives and the things that matter to them if we don't take the only chance to save them when it presents itself? So, here, that's what we'll do. Not far from our office, off the lobby, there's one final large location we haven't explored yet, where Dahl has docked his command station, the Shuttle Bay. The Shuttle Bay is an interesting location. It doesn't have much relevancy in the way of the plot, which is why we're hitting it so late, but it does tend to provide a good, consistent challenge no matter what part of the game you're at. Hit this location early, and the mimics and turrets will prove tough to deal with while you're not yet as leveled. Hit it when you're called to during this mission, and you'll have a large amount of military operators to deal with. It's also one of the locations to take best advantage of your retained knowledge of your limitations with traversal, the glue gun, hacking, and all that gameplay jazz. This security office proved a little difficult to get into on my first playthrough, until I realised you can just climb your way over the top. It's also one of the most fitting places for a nightmare encounter, in my opinion. You'll find more references to the Advent shuttle launch here because, obviously, this is the platform it launched from, and it's the crew here that sent the information up to Captain Marks. The entire plotline with the shuttle Advent is interesting to me. So much of this game is about paying attention that I'm guaranteed, with enough effort put into the decoding and without being a dingbat like me, there's gotta be something here that gives away if the Advent was definitively compromised or not. The closest theory I can come up with is that this whiteboard in the shuttle bay details the crew of the Advent before departure. Like we heard from the report sent to the captain, the Advent departed with four crew members. This included the famous pianist we talked about earlier, Gustav Leitner, and his assistant, Caroline Wheeler. Except, didn't Igwe say that Leitner was dead now?
Leitner, the pianist, is dead now.
Did Igwe just assume that? Or does he know Leitner is dead and the Leitner on board the Advent? Well, I'd love to hear your thoughts and conclusions to this in the comments if you've played the game yourself. Or if you do play it yourself, what conclusion did you come to regarding the Advent and its contamination? Okay, so remember when we found the email about only one escape pod working, sent by one Frank Jones and accidentally sent to Emmanuel instead of Emanuela? Well, moving on to the Shuttle Bay's escape pod terminal, we get contacted by Frank Jones. He's rushed to his one working escape pod and he's in there with the person he was trying to contact, Emanuela da Silva. Jones is kind of a scumbag and nobody really likes him, but Emanuela is an innocent person. The escape pod's stuck in the ejection chamber and, as with most moral posings in this game, there's three ways to go. Be the good guy, release the locking charges on the exterior and then activate the firing hatch to let the escape pod release from the chamber. Or, set the escape pod off while the tube is still jammed and watch it explode inside the chamber like a godforsaken masochist. Alternatively, the third option is do nothing. Walk away and let them starve in there. I've established I'm going the humanitarian route, so we'll help them escape Talos 1.
Thanks, Morgan. Means a lot to me that you did all that, despite Frank. I'm transmitting the location of something that could help. I couldn't get it off the station, but maybe it can help you.
The reward that Emanuela leaves us is a neuromod she was trying to smuggle off the station to help with her sick mum's medical emergency. She probably left it behind, realizing that the neuromods were linked to the Typhon invasion and thought it was too risky to take one with her, so she left it. I do recommend coming to Shuttle Bay a bit earlier because it will pop off a quest uncovering a smuggling ring that I already started and completed because I'm a telepathic wizard of the highest order, but it's a fairly fun quest that keeps you on your toes. You have to pay attention to all the fire alarms around the station and find hidden safes behind the ones with the lights on. It's fun. Aboard Dahl's shuttle, we find the directive ordered to Dahl by our father, William Yu, who effectively tells Dahl to kill us and Alex, you know, his children, and everyone on board. Clearly, the Transtar board are more concerned with protecting their company than their family. Your next task is to take out Dahl's personal operator that's messing with the systems outside the station. When you head outside, you get a call from Elazar that Dahl switched off oxygen to cargo bay in life support, and the survivors are in danger of suffocating. Now I usually head straight there because I'm a simple fella, I see a timer, I race against it. Dahl is hiding out in life support, so you can kill two birds with one stone here, incapacitate Dahl while you fix the power supply in cargo bay. There's a puzzle in the oxygen control room where you can take out Dahl by fixing these fans and then cutting oxygen supply to his control room, but it's honestly easier to just run in there and zap him with the stun gun. We fix the oxygen in cargo bay, get Dahl set up with Igwe, ready to reset his neuromods.
Send him to the penis explosion chamber and have his penis exploded immediately!
And take out his tech officer. Look at me. Look at me! I'm the operator now. Oh man, being one of these operators is actually insanely powerful. I have been desperately underutilizing the Typhon powers. Igwe undergoes the procedure and informs the memory-wiped Dahl of the Typhon situation. Omitting the whole, he was sent to kill us thing, our survivors now have a pilot that can take them off the station back to Earth and save their lives. We're in the endgame now.
Whoa! No way! It's like the title of the movies!
Walter Dahl has been taken care of. We have the data for the prototype null wave transmitter. And, finally, Alex is comfortable meeting up with us.
I promised you my arming cape. All I ask is you hear me out first. And you can blow Talos 1 to pieces if that's what you think is best. I don't think you'll do it. I know. Because I used to think we couldn't be trusted to play with fire without burning the house down. But you convinced me. You showed me anything was possible, even if the price was steep. That part of you is still in there. We can make history, Morgan. Not those leeches on the Transtar board of directors, not Mom and Dad. You and I. Just like we planned. We've got the data to confirm what you suspected. And Carl is broadcasting a neural signal. A secret message reaching to the stars. What I want to know is, what is the message?
and who is listening to it. I think you know. Ever since we first tested the Typhon Neuromods, you've known. This fabrication plan is for the null-wave device prototype you conceived. It will hijack the coral signal and use it to deliver a massive shock to every Typhon organism at once. Take it. And the army key, like I pro... What? Morgan!
Alex will die in the vacuum if you don't get him back to his bunker. In the off chance you don't care, everything he's just said is repeated in a transcribe in there, along with his arming key. We have our options now: blow the station and this thing invading it into oblivion, or try and use the mega null wave to take out all the Typhon. Now it's time to hear from every major character in the game, so feel free to stand still for 10 fucking minutes for a deluge of transcribe messages. I'll talk about this later. Igwe and Alex are still about the only ones who want to try and save all the research, while everyone else is more concerned with a surefire way to save Earth by destroying the station for good. The arrival of the giant alien is hitting everyone hard. Austin is positively legless over it. We're planning to blow up the station, so we make our way down to the reactor so we can prime it with the two arming keys.
Kill them.
Adrenaline. And another dose of Morgan's cell light. Do it.
After that, it's a matter of making your way to the bridge. Igwe, Michaela, and the rest of the survivors have made it to the shuttle bay by the time we reach it. Their safety is assured. When we reach the captain's terminal, we find Alex and January, moral nemeses finally meeting, bickering. If you let this run its course, Alex will pull a gun on January, who'll just zap him unconscious. If you activate the self-destruct early, Alex gives up. He can't go back, and we can't go back either. When we activate the self-destruct, our goal is to destroy all the Typhon contamination. There's just one problem with that. We've been installing and activating Typhon-based abilities through the whole game. The Typhon is in us. We didn't know if the advent or the escape pod were compromised, but we know we are. January sends an artificial message telling Michaela to take off without us. We can't go back with them to Earth, and Alex is too beyond saving. There's nothing left to do than sit in the captain's chair and go down with the ship.
Warning, reactor detonation imminent. Please evacuate Talos 1.
If you want to activate the null wave device, it's a matter of heading to Psychotronics instead of the reactor and planting the null wave on the original Verona 1 satellite. Its signals will amplify when you activate it from the bridge. And hey, if January pulls up on our bro again, we can jump in there first. Activating the null wave is an immediate ending. No one's gonna die, so you don't have a fate to accept or not accept. No matter the decision, you get taken to a final post-credits ending. Remember all the flashes and cryptic scenes we've been seeing throughout the game? Well, this is what it's been alluding to. Igwe, Michaela, and Eleazar have, like January with us, had their moral consciousness built into their own operators, and they're watching over us with Alex. The entirety of the game has been a re-simulation of events to test our moral standing because, as it turns out, we're not Morgan. Where Morgan's consciousness put into a Typhon organism.
You can hear us, can't you? Here. I want to show you something. What you experienced was a reconstruction based on Morgan's memories. That's... is the world today.
The Typhon hit Earth long ago. We never prevented an invasion. Now, Alex and team are trying to take a different approach to end hostilities. This is your basic moral evaluation ending. The three of the secondary characters will just make judgments on you based on whether or not you help them. It's not in depth at all. And finally, probably the worst offender of this game, after the entire journey and point of the game, establishing your moral standing and who you are consistently, you get to decide whether you want to join up with the humans or just kill everyone in the room. This is so pointless. This shouldn't be a choice. I could theoretically save everyone and be the most humanitarian player possible and then just slaughter everyone at the end. Why? This is even worse than just a slight change in ending based off your moral slider. It completely negates everything you've done in a game based off the theme of morals. Come on, man. I truly believe that for as much as Bioshock, System Shock, and Prey are compared to each other, they never do anything truly worse or better than the other, just differently. Except here, Bioshock's ending implementation is so much better. There, your moral choices actually lead to an entirely different outcome for the character that you don't get to choose at the end. Not just the same ending with a slight difference, and especially not one that nullifies the point of the story. Talk about a null wave transmitter, this fucking ending is a massive null wave. I feel like multiple endings for games are getting worse. Anyone else feel that way? Pick whichever one you want, it's just an achievement choice. I don't care. Pull the plug. I'll kill you. And that's Prey. That's the story anyway. I want to talk, as usual, more in depth about its flaws that hold it back a bit, and the especially fantastic elements that compensate for those flaws and make it worth playing yourself. I've made it clear in my videos that I don't think there's any such thing as a perfect piece of media, or one that does absolutely everything 100% horribly. Even the worst films have at least one silver thread, and even the best games of all time have at least one negative inclusion in them. And Prey is no exception. The biggest flaw that Prey suffers from is the biggest flaw that, in my experience, befalls all in-depth RPGs, and that's bugs. You've already seen a couple here, but at times, as with most games that have massive open worlds and tons of potential capabilities, this game is jittery and too versatile for its own good. The biggest offender is corpse glitches. This is a personal gripe, but in open world adventures and RPGs, I despise when a collectible, or the quest for a collectible, glitches, and you can't get a complete 100% set of said collectible. Here, with Prey, it seems almost absolute. You're theoretically able to find every crew member of Talos 1 and can track and complete that personnel collection through the security terminals, but I have never, not once, had a playthrough where all the bodies have shown up. At least one disappears or falls unreachably through the environment, and I've never had a full set. This playthrough was actually the worst offender I've had, because it was a phantom corpse, Nicole Haig, that glitched out of the environment, and it's one that's linked to a side quest, so I wasn't even able to activate the quest, let alone complete it. Even so, I've never been lucky enough to find every single crew member on board for this reason, on both the PC and console versions of the game. Very frustrating. You've heard me make reference to it throughout this video, and I'm sure some players didn't notice it, but there is too much talking over the transcribes in this game. I know that sounds weird as a gripe, and sure, if you were a survivor on a space station, you'd want to keep in constant contact with other survivors. I actually think it's more of a structural problem, and I've shown you examples of this in the reactor room and the exterior when hitting the coral nodes and Dahl's operator. Almost every time you hit an important plot moment, fulfill an important task, or when you're just about to fulfill an important task, three fucking people have to pop up and one by one tell you what they thought about it, or give you a new task.
The problem is, right after you complete a task, you're met with consequences. Enemies come after you, or you move on to a new area you haven't cleared out yet. It's not structured in a way where you can continue forward while listening to the updates, then focus on combat or clearing through an area. You have to come to a dead stop, sometimes even actively hide away, in order to properly hear the plot updates, wait till they're done, and then walk a few feet into whatever ungodly situation's gonna pull your attention. A good example is when you first step into deep storage. There's a good handful of mimics and phantoms walking around a dozen feet ahead of you, but first, Alex and January have to deliberate over the area. You're always moving, which means you're always doing something or focusing on something. Transcribes, like audio logs in Bioshock, should have been placed carefully and used effectively only when necessary. I actually had to keep non-plot related audio clips to a minimum in this review because most of my recordings of them are ruined, interrupted whenever I go into the weapon menu or combat focus while I'm trying to deal with shit on screen before listening to someone regurgitate a bunch of information to me. I don't know, I just hate having four characters talk over each other when I just want to move forward or focus on staying alive. Talking of transcribes, this is a lot more specific, and I guess is more of a nitpick, but there's a quest linked to the nightmare encounters where you can either attract or repel the nightmare using transcribe audio logs to either keep it off your back in early unpowered stages or bring it to you to farm for exotic materials. You get 5 uses for these satellite transmissions. The problem is, the game always seems to assume they're unlistened to transcribes, so they take priority as the next new transcribe. If you want to listen to new transcribes after you complete this quest, you have to constantly go into the menus and go to the audio log menu and open the new transcribe manually, every time. Only when you run out of these satellite transmissions does it stop doing this, considering the 5-use log finally opened. Either complete this quest late in game, when it's completely pointless to either repel or attract the nightmare manually, or get ready to go into the menus all the time until it's completely used up. Super annoying.
It's more than sad, it's cringe.
Let's see, what else don't I like about this game? Oh, how about the name? You know, Arkane didn't want to call this game Prey at all, but Bethesda insisted on attaching an existing IP to it to drum up interest. Funnily enough, I think people were so confused by its non-existent connection to the original game Prey that it actually hurt the game's reputation more than it helped it, which just goes to prove, once again, that your shitty-ass corporate decisions need to be left in the fucking rubbish bin where they belong, and just let creative minds work their goddamn magic. Come on, Bethesda. Your best game of the past 10 years isn't even your game, it's Arkane's. For the record, I saw someone on Reddit suggest the title Neuroshock, and that is such a better title. It's its own new IP while paying homage to the games that it's inspired by, like System Shock and Bioshock, an unofficial triad of shock games, if you will. Other titles would have worked well, like Psychomod or Talos or Null Shock. Any of these echo the game's tone, setting, theme, and elements. Prey? I pray that Bethesda has nothing to do with a sequel. The last thing I really want to say I don't like is the hacking minigame. Now, I don't think it's particularly bad or difficult, but that's really the problem. The first few times, it's fine, but the 59th time is just a waste of gameplay and presents no thought or challenge or interest. Unfortunately, this issue isn't exclusive to Prey. Some of the best games suffer from these mindless minigames in response to the need for applicable skills. Developers often use these as a way to break up the general gameplay style, so you're not doing the same thing for hours at a time. But I'd rather do one well-designed thing for 5 hours straight than try and do 5 poorly designed things over the space of an hour. I've done a video on fishing minigames in gaming where I talked about the variety with which many games approach that system, and because of fishing's ability to apply to multiple aspects in their respective games, often with collecting, cooking, or money making, I think it's the best example of this kind of thing. The absolute worst, in my opinion, is blacksmithing. I'd love to be proven wrong in the comments, but I personally have never seen a good blacksmithing minigame, even in the best of games.
and I believe hacking comes in close second. At best, it's mildly engaging for a bit while you get the point of it. At worst, it's tedious right from the get-go. Praise hacking is relatively fast-moving, which is the best thing something like this can be, but it doesn't stop it from being a nebulous break when considered within the overall experience of the game. I recently watched a hbomberguy video that touches on this subject, and I highly recommend listening to his thoughts on this. It's very on point.
You and me, we're friends, right? So I can trust you with this. I have the pet theory that all hacking minigames are bad, even when they're good. I can't wait to justify this.
When you have to do them a lot, they start to really distract from the game you want to actually be playing. This isn't a recent trend that started after Deus Ex. It's a constant in gaming history that Deus Ex avoided. Many of the game's developers used to work at Looking Glass Studios, the company that produced System Shock 1 and 2.
You again.
System Shock 2 has a hacking minigame in it, and it's a fine minigame, but the problem is, it isn't fine 100 times. System Shock 2 is only a groundbreaking survival horror RPG set on a cool space station some of the time. A lot of the time, System Shock 2 is a simplistic puzzle game you play in the corner of your screen. Hacking minigames were already a thing in 1999, and they were already pretty clearly not the best idea.
I feel I may be missing some stuff there, but that's just a handful of points to prove that this game is as flawed and human as any other piece of creative media. As for the rest of the game, I love it. I think it works great. I'm actually going to do something else here and make a call to arms. Let me know if you think I'm missing any flaws in the comments, if you've played the game and can think of any yourself. Or you could just gush over the game about how much you love it, like I'm about to do. A lot of this stuff I've already been fawning over through the video, but I'd like to go into more detail here. When I call my essays such and such a thing is underrated, it's for a reason, and even though Prey has a great following already, if I had to pinpoint anything to call this game underrated for, it's the effort. The devil in the detail. All the information the developers and writers had to be paying attention to make all these people connect, make every piece of work on the whiteboards make sense for its location, make the continuity of those locations, codes and items make total sense. It must have been so fun for them, but also such a huge challenge. It's the quintessential element necessary for an immersive sim, and they fucking nailed it. As I said earlier, a lot of it isn't necessary to understand the plot, but it is necessary to understand the world you're in, which transitions me neatly to another reason this game is so great. Play versatility. I mentioned in my Sunset Overdrive video that the freedom there extends far beyond the controls, in that the design of the world gives you a choice of why you want to play, as well as how. Clearly, games like that must be my kink, because Prey is very similar. You can play this game and care more, even only, about who and where you are right then and there at any specific moment. All the stuff that's just going on in front of you. Just focus on you, Alex, the Typhon, and the station. Play for a little longer and dig a little deeper, and you can start to care about all the people on the station and what it's here for, beyond Typhon research and neuromods. Spend even longer, you'll start to understand the historical events that led up to these achievements, the scientific importances of the timeline you're in. Go even deeper than that and you'll read catalogues and book excerpts that build a bigger picture of the Earth past the station, that exists beyond your play space. Not only on the subject of playstyle, you'll get different experiences out of this game depending on what space your head is in while you play it, and every time you revisit, there'll always be something new to discover. Fitting for a game that takes place on a research station, don't you think? And that's all under the skin stuff in terms of versatility. Add the challenge options, the variety of weapons and situational approaches, morality choices, the limited decisions to make with Neuromod installations. You'll have something new to look forward to each time you play. Really, the most linear thing about the game is the main story and the locations, some of which have to be discovered in a certain order thanks to the plot setup. But with so much variety going on, I'm not going to hold that against the game. Personally, there is one thing that will make me revisit a game over and over, even if you're doing the same thing every time. That's how high quality and enjoyable the atmosphere is. If the world is fun to be in, then I'll happily do the same thing in it over and over again. Take, for example, something like Journey. In retrospect, Journey is quite a linear game. There's only so many things you can interact with, only one way to complete puzzles, and areas are usually tunnels to travel one way through. But I'll be damned if I ever get bored of playing Journey. Without any dialogue, but with the music, the art style, and the emotional investment set by the world you're in, it's a joy to experience multiple times. A good example to echo that feeling in the relevancy of Prey is some of the horror-themed encounters within the game. Remember that telepath that floats by when you enter life support? That happens every single time you go down there for the first time. But it's so enjoyably structured. It's a classically envisioned spooky horror moment. It's fun every time, and it helps to set the atmosphere of the area every time. Multiple instances of these framed moments happen, and they're very much appreciated, because they fulfill that intention by the developers. The intention of keeping the horror factor, and by extension the fun factor, high. This isn't limited to linear instances. This philosophy is built into the foundation of the game and helps to breed this fantastic sense of enjoyable atmosphere, lighting, music, location structure, and that attention to detail I was talking about earlier. You wouldn't feel as if you were in danger as much if it didn't feel like the threat on board had wiped out an entire facility's worth of people. But its destruction is everywhere. The remnants of the inhabitants' final moments are captured in transcribes and corpse locations, and the ones that remain are in constant panic throughout their contact with you. Many areas are given a unique instance of atmosphere. Some I've described include the Yellow Tulip Club and the Volunteer Quarters, that constantly keeps you on your toes and punishes you for believing you've gotten a grip on what to expect. I can keep flinging poetic examples at you, but it comes down to this. In many games, you enter a world, it presents what you need for the game, and then it just leaves you with that for the whole experience. They have you doing the same nebulous things over and over again, in a world void of anything that doesn't add to the gameplay experience, because the developers didn't deem it a necessary part of the game. Why add something to a game that has nothing to do with gameplay, they sometimes think. And in some instances, this makes sense. You don't need Dark Souls-style lore to enjoy Tetris, although there's an interesting jumping off point for you indie developers who need a concept, but RPGs and immersive sims rely on this depth to fulfill the promise that their genre presents. A high level of world building, a massive variety of interactability, an intriguing and immersive story for the characters and the player to get pulled into. Sadly, some of them just don't cut the cheese. They're too blunt. Prey is not one of those games. That expertly designed atmosphere adds to the unique and well-crafted sense of horror that this game captures. Horror itself, in all its forms, is so versatile in its potential. Look at some of the best horror games and films of all time, and most of them don't even fall under the same flag of the genre. Psychological horror, body and gore horror, supernatural horror, comical B-movie horror in something like Sunset Overdrive. I'm not gonna stop referencing it. Alright, I won't yield. They all, in some way, excel at finding a way to link into that fear of the unknown. Losing someone we love and fearing for the unknown state of their safety. Fear of the unfamiliar form of something grotesque and inhuman. The fear that the dangers of the world surpass the limitations of the physical realm as we understand it. It simultaneously has the potential to be the best and the worst genre of media. How do you make someone watching something from the safety of their own home or a theatre room feel unsafe in that position? Games do this so much more easily, by having you interact with them. It's a huge divider for me, because while the supposed scariest movies have very little effect on me, video games manage to open that nerve instantaneously. Certainly, there's bad examples of horror games out there that don't understand concepts such as tension, suspension of disbelief, and unknowability. And if you watch any gaming channels that document the influx of indie horror games, you'll see far too many of these examples.
What?
But games have it easier than most media in making you feel fear because you are making decisions that will ensure either the safety or demise of your player character. In short, you're stepping into their shoes to a much more meaningful degree than with a film character.
And when the developers of a game understand what inflicts fear, instead of just making something that looks spooky, the effectiveness of that interactability becomes apparent. Fear and scariness are two different things, I feel. Jump scares are often maligned because as soon as one happens, even though you have an instinctive physical response, it doesn't do anything to your mind. You don't care afterwards. Your ancestral biology just reacted to natural danger potential. But fear is so much more mental. You have to get under someone's skin to make them feel it. It's the odds being stacked against you, the experience of something new that you don't know how to deal with, the feeling of being out of your element. This can become apparent even in everyday life, in fearful situations like a new job or a first date, or violent conflict. And that's what separates the best horror games from the flops, their ability to inflict that mental anguish on us as players, within the situations that the characters are experiencing. Fear is being lost in a silent fog within an unfamiliar town. It's the feeling of hungry alien eyes watching you from around a corner. The feeling of breathing on the back of your neck. The feeling of being a regular person out of your element in a nightmarish hell. It's the feeling of being one small person, reliant on oxygen, lost in the enormous vacuum of space, thousands of miles from survivability and safety. It's that feeling that horror games need to understand and capture, and Prey does it expertly, in my opinion. And in my opinion, it belongs up there with these titans. Feel free to disagree, obviously, but when we talk about great horror games, it'll always be Silent Hill, Resident Evil, or Amnesia that get brought up. And while those games are well worth mentioning under that banner, I believe Prey is too, for all the reasons I've just talked about. What I mentioned just then. What's that? What? What do you mean you weren't listening? I've been talking for like 2 hours. This video took a lot out of me. Literally, I lost several pounds of fat over the production. So any feedback, whether positive or critical, to help me get better is much appreciated. I wasn't joking at the beginning of this video. It was supposed to come out in October. And if you're wondering why it's so delayed, I don't want to bog this video down with a big channel update. So I'm going to make a separate big update video to coincide with this video's release, if you care. I do just want to say, every so often I get comments and messages from people saying they're waiting on the next video. And I just want to say thank you for those. It makes me feel like what I create is being appreciated by somebody somewhere else. Oh, by the way, one element of the game that I know I didn't talk about is the DLC Mooncrash. The reason I didn't bring it up at all is very simply, I haven't played Mooncrash prior to the production of this video. But I do own it now, and I do plan to make a raw first-time video playing Mooncrash on my new second gaming channel, so I will put a link to that video once it's up in the description of this video if you care to check it out. And I think that's everything. Oh man, it's been so long since I've made one of these, I've forgotten how to end videos. I don't know. Here's footage of me just vibing as a pair of headphones floating through zero gravity. Because you can do that. You can do that in Prey. I fucking love this game.